Father of bluegrass, Bill Monroe, as we explore a musical genre deeply rooted in the heart of Kentucky. Bluegrass, coming up next on Main Street. On U.S. Highway 62 to the small community of Racine in western Kentucky. The lighted booms of mammoth coal shovels sway to and fro in the distant hills. Coal is the economic livelihood here, but from this soil comes something much more precious. Racine is the home of bluegrass music. It was here back in 1911 that the youngest of a family of six boys and two girls was born and raised. He would later become known as the father of bluegrass music. The man was Bill Monroe. In an old house surrounded by coal mines, Monroe learned to endure hardship early in his life. His father died when he was just 10 years old, and his mother, a fiddle player, passed away 6 years later. He was raised by his brothers and sisters and by a relative he called Uncle Penn.
Over around Racine, Kentucky, back out on the old farms, you know, and they, when you was plowing with mules and horses, you know, and there just wasn't nothing going on, you know, just, and of course, if you wanted to sing a song, you could sing it way back there on the hill to yourself, you know, and just sing for yourself. So it's just something to think about and go through all that and do it that way. My mother, she could fiddle and she was a good dancer. She could play the accordion. But my Uncle Penn Vandiver, you know, he's on my mother's side and he was the first man I ever heard play the fiddle. And he was a wonderful uncle and could really play that old time fiddle music, you know, for people to dance to. Uncle Penn Vandiver. Monroe, he wanted to play the fiddle. Charlie, he wanted to play the guitar, and they was quite a bit older than I was, and they was bigger, and they was kind of the boss, you see. I had to do what they said to do. So the mandolin was all that was left for me. But now I'm glad that I've taken the mandolin, and it's a different style of mandolin. It's different kind of music you see in it. And I seen a gentleman here today, and he said he just wanted to hear me play a mandolin number. I practice some every day, you know, and I've taken care of my notes, you know, to where one would go to another and take care of it right. And then I learned to sing as I went along, too.
With the fame he has achieved through his unique brand of music, Bill Monroe has never forgotten the musical influences that helped him develop his style.
And the old Southern blues, I like the black people played. And Arnold Schultz, you know, from way down in Kentucky, down below Racine, down around McHenry down in that country someplace, or Central City. He was a powerful guitar player, and he could play the blues. And me and him, we worked together a good many times. And but we would play for a square dance there in Roseanne, Kentucky, you know.
Timing originally was all the was the whole of bluegrass. You know, the timing was such that it makes you want to pat your foot. You know, it's a real hard driving kind of music, and you really got to stay on top of the beat to get that effect. You know, I used to judge good players by whether or not you looked down and your foot was bouncing up and down to listen to it, because you can't hardly stop when the timing is right. When the timing is right on the money, then the solos almost shrink back by comparison. The timing is the single biggest important thing, I think, to bluegrass, and if it's there, then the solos are just that much better.
You couldn't keep from liking it. You couldn't keep from patting your feet. It had a great beat, and it has today. It's got the rhythm and the beat to it that you'll just naturally go for. but the reason in the early days that people had the country music and bluegrass was a different style. It's still country music. It was a different style and had a different beat to it. And you had to learn that rhythm.
After going on the road with his new style of music, Bill Monroe eventually found himself at the doorstep of the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, Tennessee.
After I got my group going in the kind of shape I want them in, you know, the way they could play and everything, I come up to the Grand Ole Opry, the WSM, and I come in there on a Monday. I believe I come in there on a Wednesday, and I met Solomon Judge and Harry Stone, David Stone. They was all going out to get some coffee, and I told them I'd like to audition. And they said, well, you're supposed to be here on Monday. And I said, well, I'm sorry. So they come back and they listen to me, and I run over about four, five, six numbers, and they told me, said you got your job, if you ever leave, you'll have to fire yourself. Said you the job is yours. And so I went to work that Saturday night, the last Saturday in October, 1939.
Were you nervous? Do you remember that first time?
Not a bit nervous. I could do what I wanted to do with my music, and I wasn't a bit nervous.
Like many other styles of music, the writing of bluegrass songs has become an important part of the oral folk tradition. Lyrically, the subjects of these songs cover everything from history and rural customs to male-female relationships. Instrumental bluegrass selections are usually categorized by variations on a theme, traditional melodies in many cases.
And I started writing at really an early age, you know, when I was in high school. And after I graduated from high school, well, I continued to write. I worked at other jobs, but when I get home, I sort of lived to write. You know, that was a good expression for me, and I had a guitar at that time that my cousin gave me. My cousin gave me an old guitar that belonged to Willie Basale. That was my first guitar. So, and I used what lyrics that I did write and accompany myself on the guitar.
Well, you can have some kind of a story, you know, you're thinking about, and you can come up with, start with some word, you see, and kind of tie them together as you go along, get the first line worked out there. And so then add to the next one. And it just all works together if you take your time and think about it and put it together like that.
It's a Wednesday night in Glasgow, Kentucky. At a local music store, well after normal business hours, the sign in the window still reads open. Inside, a group of musicians are swapping stories and learning new bluegrass songs.
A minor, B minor. walks on down the road. He threw up his hands and said hello. This year's in Merry Spring, where the water's pure as gold. Lay down your weary load.
We always, this is not your regular store, I don't guess. We always just encourage people to come in and hang out, you know, if they, and we keep the coffee pot on all the time and a lot of chairs around, and it's usually a little messy, but people tend to feel comfortable coming in here, and when they come in, we don't mind for them to play the instruments. We let everybody play the instruments, and a lot of times they just kind of break out, you know, a big jam will break out, and consequently, pickers seem to like to come in here and hang around.
It's in jam sessions such as these that bluegrass music comes closest to its humble beginnings, and the oral folk tradition is passed on. But even with its roots firmly implanted in western Kentucky and Appalachia, the popularity of bluegrass is sometimes overshadowed by what some people feel is the stereotypical view it projects of rural America.
People, it's almost like some people are ashamed of it. You know, honestly, it seems like people from the country are ashamed of country music. You know, they want to be more uptown or something. And oddly enough, they tell me that the big cities, you know, like Washington and stuff, is booming with bluegrass. You know, and Lexington is a great bluegrass town, they say. And like I said, I don't get around much, but that's what they tell me. I don't know. We have a few people around that play it.
I don't know. I believe what Kenny said was right, that people are almost ashamed of their own heritage, you know. They'd rather wear a mask of saying that they're somebody else and not be proud of who they really are, you know, and be proud of their heritage. If they knew how rich it really was, that they would be extremely proud of all these forms of music, like country music. And, I mean, true country music, you know, like Vernon Dalhart wrote it, or bluegrass like Bill Monroe, and music like folk music. There's a world of folk music here too. It's I think is, you know, still truly alive, and it's passed on through families, and it's kept probably into the family, and not really, you know, made that public, I guess.
The interesting thing we have found in doing a lot of research, market research for the music, is that the people involved in bluegrass music, for example, or the people who enjoy listening to bluegrass music, I think one of the statistics we like to quote is that they're 10 times more likely to be in the upper income brackets than those people who listen to country music. So there's a large contingency of people out there who are upper-class people, upper-middle-class people who really enjoy the music, follow the music very closely. And that is just in direct, you know, the direct opposite of what most people's impression is.
From the pine forests of Oregon to the green mountains of Vermont, bluegrass music festivals have gained a reputation for being exciting and fun entertainment.
The festivals, you know, it's no thing of who's the best or who's better than the next guy. It's just guys sitting around doing their thing and playing. And it's the greatest atmosphere in the world. Whether you're a listener or a player, to go in and hear people just playing for the sake of playing seems to be probably the greatest thing, the greatest form of music. In fact, that's what I always tell people that come in here to the store, and they say, well, I'm not very good at this, or I don't do very well. And I think the greatest form of success is being able to do whatever you do on the instrument and enjoy it. And you won't find anybody at the festivals that's not just having a big time.
But in the environment where it developed, bluegrass remains an important part of family and culture.
In my own intermediate family, when my grandmother grandfather and aunt, all my aunts would play music. Junior played the guitar, and Aunt Lula played the played the banjo and the mandolin, and Aunt Lula played the fiddle, and sometimes played the. They all interchanged. They could all play all those instruments. Play the banjo and the guitar, and they'd all just swap around. Everybody played music, and they say that they'd be playing music, you know, at night, and the next neighbors, they whoever was pretty close would get out on their front porch and would listen, you know, while they played their style of music.
With his hard work and dedication, Bill Monroe was able to make a career out of the music he pioneered. But as the bluegrass style grows in popularity, those who follow in his footsteps are finding the competition stiff and the road to success long and hard.
But it seems sad to me that the greatest players on the planet end up a lot of times not doing as well as they should, or working for somebody who can't even play, you know, some singer somewhere. That always kind of hurt my feelings, you know, but... And a lot of the greatest players around aren't even making any money, you know, they're not even making a living at it. And I've always thought that's sad. This society doesn't really seem to support the arts as such. They wanna dance, or they wanna, you know, hear the beat, you know. I don't know. Don't wanna seem bitter about it. But I'm quitting. I'll never play again.
Well, John Hartford said, he told it as a joke, but I guess it's true. He said, you know, there was this frog on the ground, and the frog said, told this woman that he met, said, pick me up, kiss me, I'll turn into a bluegrass musician. And so she just put it in her pocket and walked on down the road. Got on down the road, and the frog saw another woman. He kind of got up out of her pocket and said, hey, kiss me, I'll turn into a bluegrass musician. That woman said, why didn't you kiss that frog? So he said he'd turn into a bluegrass musician. She said, I can make more money with talking frog than I can a bluegrass musician.
In the 1970s and 80s, bluegrass began to mix with other styles of music as musicians helped to bring the musical genre to new levels of technical proficiency.
But now it's become a very challenging form of music, you know. It's almost like the hillbilly jazz, you know, because the players now have gotten so deep. In fact, your good fiddlers now, they almost have to have classical technique to be able to do it, because it evolved to the point that it's a very deep form of music, and the solos that are taken, it's very instrumental. Even the songs usually have a lot of fiery solos in them, you know, where each instrumentalist gets a chance to take a break, and it's become a very deep form and challenging form of music, and it's a lot of fun to play.
Well, here's the thing about that. If you come with a new way of playing something, there's a lot of young people, you know, that's just they probably want to hear something new. So they've got a lot of people to play to just that way. Of course, the old time fans and friends, they still want to hear the old time bluegrass the way it was played years ago.
The renewed interest in bluegrass music throughout the world soon made it necessary to organize a professional organization dedicated solely to the advancement of the art form.
Well, the IBMA was created about 5 years ago, back in 1985, as a professional trade organization, and many of the industry's, music industry's leaders came together and saw the need for some organizational framework to really unify the industry.
Ooh, tell them about it.
At the old schoolhouse, Johnson Mountain Boys.
Been quite well received. We are, I guess, our list of membership is reads kind of like a who's who in the bluegrass music industry. We also have fan memberships, and we have a lot of people who are very active in the organization as patrons to the music, but our voting membership are professionals.
Today, the high lonesome sound pioneered by Bill Monroe not only echoes in the hills of Kentucky and Appalachia, but in regions throughout the world.
We had a letter from Nigeria that was handwritten on a, looked like almost a scrap piece of paper. They had heard bluegrass music on Voice of America somehow broadcast into Africa, and we're not sure from where. And we've been very impressed by the number of people in Russia and particularly in Moscow, who have come forward in the last probably 12 months saying how popular it is there. And they were very surprised to find that bluegrass is not, you know, the most popular music, if you will, in North America, but they really see it as a very unique American, very unique to America.
Japan, England, Italy, all the countries there, Germany, they love bluegrass music. Bluegrass is a music that will learn you a lot if you play it and play it right. It'll take you a long ways.
Now, how would you like to be remembered?
As the father of bluegrass music.
Simply put, that's it.
Ocean. If I don't change my notion, I've just got to forget you if I can. But I'm feeling so blue, I don't know what to do, because I'm head over heels in love with you. I can't stand the thought of losing you. Well, I'm feeling so blue, I don't know what to do, because I'm head over heels in love with you. Sit and worry, I can't stand the thought of losing you. Well, I'm feeling so blue, I don't know what to do, because I'm head over heels in love with you. But this life ain't worth living if I've got to sit and worry over you. Well, I'm feeling so blue, I don't know what to do, because I'm head over heels in love with you. I'm feeling so blue, I don't know what to do, because I'm head over heels in love with you.
Grammar isn't dull. I want to apply to you one beautiful thing about grammar and about writing itself. There's a symbiosis between writing and thinking that is going to delight you, that is going to make your whole life different if you can really come to grips with it. The more precisely you write, the more precisely you can think, because you think in words.